All right, so good morning, everyone. My name is Bilyana Petkova, and I'm a fellow here at the Information Law Institute. It is my pleasure to introduce the second panel of this conference. So we're going to talk about automated decision-making and challenges to explanation giving. So I think this is the starting point of, or it has a nice link to the previous panel, a starting point to the discussion whether actually explanations are possible, to what extent we could rely on giving explanations. And we have a great lineup of speakers here. We are going to change the order of the presentations a little. So first, we'll have Jenna Burrell, who is an associate professor at Information Law in UC Berkeley. Then we'll have Solon Barocas, who is a Microsoft research fellow, and he's actually coming home as he's a previous fellow. He was a previous fellow here at the Information Law Institute at the NYU. And last but not least, we'll have Duncan Watts, who is a computational social scientist at Microsoft Research. So without further ado, I'll give the floor to Jenna.
So I thought I'd use my 15 minutes up here to give an overview of the paper that I contributed to this workshop, which I believe is available to everyone. The title of the paper is How the Machine Thinks. It was published in 2016 in the journal Big Data and Society. I wanted to explain a little bit about how this paper came about, and I have some ideas now about where I might go next with this line of thinking. The paper deals with the opacity of machine learning algorithms in particular. And so to kind of set the scene, I think this was around 2013, I suddenly started to notice that this word algorithms was appearing in sort of strange places. It was appearing in the mass media, in advertising, and I was starting to see that legal scholars and social scientists were using this word. And there were these new connotations that were coming to be attached to that term. And I thought it was a little weird for me, and I'll explain why. One reason is because my undergraduate degree was in computer science, and so I spent 4 years studying algorithms. That's the thing that we study as computer science majors, and we just didn't talk about algorithms in the same way as I was starting to hear, media people talking about algorithms. So I thought there was maybe an opportunity in the scholarship in this space to try and bridge between my background in computer science and my graduate training, which is actually in sociology. So I'm going to, I think actually it's probably useful for me to go first because I wanted to talk just a little bit about what machine learning algorithms are. So among the vast realm of algorithms, these were the particular class of algorithms that I thought needed a little bit more kind of scrutiny. So machine learning algorithms are powerful generalizers and predictors. I have here an image of a neural network, which I'm not going to really get into, but there it is for you to take a look at. They look like this. And they learn by training on lots and lots and lots of examples, thousands or tens of thousands or millions of examples. So for example, if you are trying to build a spam filter, you would give your learning algorithm lots and lots and lots of examples of both spam emails and non-spam emails, which are often called ham emails. And what that learning algorithm produces at the end of its training is a classifier. So machine learning algorithms are really split into these kind of two operations, learning and classifying. And I apologize to the computer scientists in the room, I'm really oversimplifying things, but I think that's probably useful for this audience. So once you have this classifier, then you can take a new example, an email that came into your inbox, run it through the classifier, and it will tell you that it thinks that it's either spam or not. And that's very useful. That kind of generalization capability can be very, very useful. For various reasons, machine learning algorithms are in more widespread real-world use today than ever before, so that was one reason why I thought they deserved some special attention. The other reason is because they're known by computer scientists to have an opacity problem. So you have your spam filter, and it can tell you this email is probably spam, but it often can't really tell you why. So you just have to trust it. Okay, and then I've included just kind of a range of applications that machine learning algorithms are used for, so things like credit card fraud detection, spam filtering, which I'll talk about a little bit more, things like disease diagnosis. Okay, so why worry about opacity? So now I'm putting my sociologist hat on, and my concern, which is shared with many others, is that these, specifically these machine learning algorithms, are being used to do very kind of socially consequential forms of classification. And there is the possibility there for misclassification. So you can get false positives or false negatives. You can get spam that's or emails that are not spam that are classified as spam, for example. And even worse, those misclassifications may disproportionately affect certain groups. So that could be members of protected classes like defined by race or gender or age or religion, for example. I'm again oversimplifying things. It's not just about misclassification, but I think that's sort of a clear way to see why a sociologist might be concerned and what is the problem with forms of misclassification. You know, if we're talking about things like deciding whether someone gets a loan, deciding whether someone gets a job interview, those are really important pathways to social mobility. And so if those pathways are possibly being blocked by algorithmic forms of classification, there's a potential that forms of inequality are either reinforced or exacerbated. And if we're talking about algorithms in particular, because we often can't, you know, with machine learning algorithms, we don't know why something has been classified the way it has, that presents a problem for trying to identify and tackle some of those problems of misclassification. Okay, so the point of my paper was to the intervention in the article was to try and clarify that what I was sort of seeing in this emerging scholarship were actually three forms of algorithmic opacity that were often being conflated. And I wanted to show how these were different forms of opacity because they really suggest distinct solutions for preventing harm. I'm going to kind of rush through this because I really want to talk about this last example, which is a kind of inherent opacity. But the first form is a kind of opacity that is, you know, intentional and perhaps justifiable, right? So the Google search engine, they're not going to show you their code. They don't want you to know exactly how that algorithm works because then their competitors will steal it. Or people who want to improve their search engine rankings will know how to game the algorithm. There's a whole industry in search engine optimization that attempts to do that. But they face the challenge of not knowing exactly how the algorithm works. The concern there is that it's possible for organizations like Google to use that code to cover ways in which they may be flouting regulations. And so the way to maybe address that problem is to use like a trusted third party who can read the code and do a kind of regulatory audit. Maybe that's the kind of medium ground between opening up the algorithm to everyone's scrutiny and preventing anyone from seeing exactly how it works. The second form of opacity really has to do with the fact that implementing algorithms, writing code, is a specialist skill. Not everyone here probably knows how to do it. Many of you do, but not everyone. And so there's a barrier to understanding how algorithms work that's based on the fact that it requires some training. The way to kind of address that perhaps is through education campaigns. I know at the Berkeley campus we have, you know, there's a lot of interest in developing computational literacy in students, and there are these campaigns to teach everyone, you know, in K-12 education how to code. So maybe that's the way to address that form of opacity. And then the last form, which I'm describing as a kind of inherent opacity, it's a bit more complicated. So machine learning algorithms do a form of mathematical optimization in high dimensionality. But if we're trying to answer the why question, why did this email get classified as spam, we're really going to be demanding human scale explanations. And the tendency, I think, is to often apply distinctively human styles of semantic interpretation to what we can extract from how the algorithm has learned. And I'm going to talk about that in a little bit more detail. So I wanted to basically go over an a code audit of my own, where I attempted to extract an explanation from a very, very simplified machine learning algorithm. And the example, the application that I was looking at was spam filtering. So in my early stages of my career, I was studying internet cafes and internet use in West Africa. I spent months and months in the country Ghana. Nearby is another country, Nigeria, which probably people are familiar with the famous Nigerian scam emails. And as I spent time there, I started to worry that, you know, the way these machine learning algorithms work, it may be the case that simply living in Ghana or Nigeria might make it so that your emails tend to fall into that false positive category more than other people's emails. So if you're Nigerian, do you have trouble with your emails being classified as spam because of your connection to Nigeria? So I ran this, you know, small code audit, a very simplified machine learning algorithm. I used a support vector machine. I trained it on an admittedly very dated public corpus, the Spam Assassin corpus, which is from 2002, very dated. So that's basically a set of emails that are already classified as spam or not. And what came out of that process, basically it was looking at the email, just very simply, the words contained in the email itself. And it was coming up with basically a list of weights attached to every word, which would tell you which words were more associated with spam and which words were less associated with spam. And so what I found for the word Nigeria was that it was actually a neutral word. There was basically a weight of almost zero, and which was reassuring. So that suggests that, you know, looking inside the algorithm itself, you can see that, you know, trained on that particular corpus of data, simply mentioning Nigeria or having references to Nigeria in your email is not going to make the spam filter more attuned to it. And then there were a lot of other words. So looking at the words that were most associated with spam, those words included the word hour, the word click, the word remove, the words guarantee and please, references to money, that's not surprising, price, the word will, the word most, and the word want. Those were the words that were the most associated with spam. And so if you're running this classifier on an email, those are the words that are going to kind of set off an alarm bell in the classifier algorithm. So I realize I'm running out of time, but I had a couple of emails just looking at sort of at the decision level, how did emails get classified as spam or not? The email on your left is a spam email, and it has all the kind of features of the Nigerian email scam. The email on the right is an email from my research assistant in Ghana. And if you actually read the text, there are actually some kind of similarities in narrative style. And the classifier accurately categorized the email on the left as spam and the email on the right as not spam. So that, you know, that's great. But if you actually look at the words that it cued in on, it starts to get a little bit confusing. That doesn't actually give a very clear explanation. So both of these emails had these sort of spammy words. They both made reference to money. The one on the left, however, was categorized as spam. And I think kind of walking away from that attempt to sort of audit spam filtering as a process and look inside the algorithm and look at some examples of email, my point is really to just show that, you know, the ways in which we make sense and try to explain what's happening in a spam filter really use a kind of human style of interpretive reasoning, and that's being imposed on what's really a mathematical process of optimization, which may be providing partial and not complete explanations and potentially giving us false reassurance. Some of the words made sense. References to money, of course you would see that in spam emails. But other words didn't really seem to make sense to me. So the word want or visit or hour, why are those words associated with spam? And in the end, it's not about these individual words, it's about the aggregation of, you know, thousands of words in an email that ultimately determine what is spam and what isn't. All right, I'm out of time. So, and actually I'm on my last slide, so that's great. I'm really interested now in looking a little further into how computer scientists think about explanation. They do, they care about explanation too. And, you know, one question is why do they? So I'm now attempting to use, you know, a mere undergraduate level training in computer science to read some more technical papers and see how it is exactly that computer scientists are raising the issue of explanation and where there's some overlap between these kind of legal and social scientific concerns and computer scientist concerns. And there are some areas of overlap and other areas where there's just not a lot. So, and there are techniques that are being devised to provide explanations, which perhaps, like algorithmic techniques or visualization techniques, that might be useful to us as a community who are interested in this question of explanation. And I think the kind of final question in this space for me is, in light of, you know, these questions above, what are the barriers and opportunities for pursuing interdisciplinary work? You know, particularly for the things that concern me as a sociologist, that relate to things like fairness and discrimination. All right, oh, that's perfect, perfect timing. Okay.
Many thanks, Jenna. Now we have Solon Barocas answer all these provocative questions.
Very quick, does anyone know how to do presenter tools on Windows? No? Okay.
Presenter tools.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, okay. Great. Well, let's see how this goes. I am Solon Barocas. Thanks for having me back. I'll actually, I think, pick up precisely where Jenna left off. And in particular, I'll start by just explaining that there is a widely held belief among computer scientists and people who use machine learning in practice that there is this kind of tension between the performance of the models that they develop and their interpretability of those models. And I imagine you will hear a considerable amount more about this over the next 2 days. I just want to point out a paper, actually, that Duncan, in fact, cites as the very first paper in his article that I highly recommend you read, which was an important piece from 2001 by Leo Bremen, an important figure in machine learning, basically arguing what has become this widely accepted belief that there are sort of two approaches to modeling, one which cares very much about trying to estimate the causal mechanism, trying to really understand what causally accounts for some particular outcome, and here you often aim for parsimony, something relatively simple and interpretable, and then a new style of modeling, which is much more in the school of machine learning, where you don't have concerns about interpretability or parsimony, and instead just care about performance. And he walks through in this paper a series of very compelling examples about how this new style of modeling has been very effective in dealing with sort of intractable problems of getting computers to do things. And, you know, later on, this became a kind of more popular point in media discourse and kind of the popular coverage of these things, sort of ending up in this very well-known article by Chris Anderson, sort of arguing that we no longer need to rely on theory, we can just learn models from data, right? And so, in a way, these are all part of a similar argument suggesting that we can get greater performance if we are willing to sacrifice interpretability. Of course, there is a considerable amount of concern about this, as Jenna mentioned, even among practitioners themselves, and so I just wanted to point to a DARPA project that sort of tries to illustrate this trade-off between interpretability and performance, and what is being shown here is that different machine learning methods are seen as producing more or less interpretable models, but as you'll notice, there's a kind of slope here which suggests that the methods that are more likely to produce high accuracy are also those that are less explainable, less interpretable, right? And so this sort of is a rendering of this more general point that I was making a moment ago. Okay, what I thought I would do is actually try to give a taste for what is the source of inscrutability here. I think we often assert it to be the case. Jenna did a really fantastic job explaining how this works with spam, but I want to try to walk through progressively more complex aspects of modeling that quickly introduce the kind of inscrutability to the model. And if I do a bad job, I'm going to pretend that it's because it's inscrutable, not because I'm failing to do a good job explaining these concepts. Well, let me start. So, to begin with, you can imagine a very, very, very simple credit scoring model where you just are plotting length of employment to kind of creditworthiness, right? Or the likelihood that you will not default. And so a linear model will simply, and this is the simplest you can imagine, for every, you know, increase of one for the length of employment, you get a corresponding increase of one for creditworthiness. And so this is kind of the simplest way you can imagine a model working. I mean, when you hear model, you often think of something like a diorama. Like, this is actually what is a model in the most basic sense, right? But you can complicate this, right? So you can imagine something nonlinear, right? So it's a little less intuitive how the value of the credit score increases as length of employment increases, right? So it may not be simply that the slope is constant, but actually, as you move further along the x-axis, suddenly you get a much more radical shift in the rate of the value of the y-axis, right? And so again, you can imagine that maybe you have some intuitions about this, you can extrapolate very easily. Here it becomes a little less obvious, right? But let's go further. Let's say that we have what is called a non-monotonic function. So the idea here is monotonicity is, does the value increase in the same direction as the value of the other feature increase, right? Does length of employment as an increase always correspond to an increase in the credit score? And increasingly, we have these kinds of functions where that's not the case, where it may be true for some part of the time, right? So as you stay in your place of residence for some part of the time, credit scores go up. But as you go down, as you continue to live there, maybe for some reason credit scores go down, right? And so you might tell a just-so story, something like maybe you're a less valuable customer once you no longer have debts, something like that. But this is just a way of saying, again, that like your intuitions about what it actually means to say that this variable is important don't necessarily correspond to what the model is really doing, right? Okay, let me now make this even more complicated. And this is the part where I'm sure to get this wrong. let's add one additional dimension, right? So I showed you the straight line. Now let's add not just, let's add different dimensions here, right? So I was talking about length of employment, but let's consider sort of how income and outstanding debts relate to each other and how they ultimately contribute to the predicted credit score, right? So what you see here is that, not surprisingly, the more debt you have, the lower your credit score, right? That's this kind of, you can think of this as the x-axis. But what's important here is that there's also a different relationship with income. As income goes up, it seems to kind of modulate the relationship to debt in the sense that the more your income, it sort of brings up your credit score despite the fact that you might have considerable debt, right? So what this is showing is that even like a two features interacting this way can very quickly become far less intuitive, right? Okay, now let's imagine that this is the case in a nonlinear fashion, right? Where it's even less obvious what you would say. Like, there's certain parts of this surface where you might be able to say, like, yes, income can kind of compensate for the fact that I have debts, but it doesn't do so in a way that's consistent across the space. But then this is, I think, the most compelling example. Let's imagine that actually income has different effects depending on your level of debt. So for people who have low income, having more debt brings their credit score gradually down. That's this corner here, right? Well, actually, I have a pen. Very nice. Okay. However, for people who are high income, you actually find that as debt increases, in fact, their credit score goes up, right? So you can imagine this kind of making some intuitive sense. You could tell a story again here, right? Very wealthy people can sustain a significant amount of debt, and in fact, they might be very creditworthy, very attractive as credit candidates. So again, just imagine, like, how do you kind of account for this? How do you explain to someone what is the importance of these features given the type of person they might be? And so I've just done this in three dimensions using two different features. But the point is, as Jenna was mentioning, is that these models actually are across many, many, many dimensions, right? And the reason that we only talk about them using these kinds of diagrams is we can't even visualize things past three dimensions, right? Okay. So let me just, you know, firepower here. Let's imagine something where, you know, there just really is a very complex relationship where this is non-linear, this is non-monotonic. this is still just two features, right? Just contemplate that, right? So this is just two features, but the relationship is highly complex across those two features, right? And so to think about how one would go about trying to explain this is really not obvious. And so one way you might think about it is like, can I as a human looking at this, and you could probably represent this mathematically as well, actually step through all the processes that would produce certain kinds of outcomes, right? But a different way of doing this, which draws on the work that I'm doing with Andrew, in fact, this comes from the same paper, hello, Andrew, is, okay, let's say we don't want to try to explain the full logic represented by this kind of decision-making process. We just want to account for a specific decision. So let's say, in a particular, there's someone over here in this kind of valley. That's where you would, like, their actual value, the value of their features for debts and incomes correspond to this, right? And what you want to do maybe is figure out what is the global maximum value for a credit score. And you might think it's like somewhere up here at the top of this mountain, I guess, right? And so one way you might try to explain what was the important feature in this particular decision for this person that was over here is to actually measure how far they have to travel on the x-axis and measure how far they would have to travel on the y-axis to get to this global maximum, okay? And what this lets you do, and this is apparently what a lot of people in credit scoring actually do, is just rank order the amount you would have to move to get to the global maximum, and then that is a way of saying which feature is actually the one dragging you down the most. But you could imagine a totally different situation where you're not trying to tell the person how far you away on this particular dimension from the greatest possible value. Maybe what you want to tell them instead is something like, actually, this is the dimension on which you were closest to being to getting credit, right? So if you had a minor change in this particular feature, then you would have actually been giving credit. And as far as we understand, having talked to some people in industry and regulators, that there isn't really consistency in the way that credit scoring agencies do this. So this is just to give you a sense of how quickly even very, very simple models can become very hard to understand, despite the fact that we might be able to produce accounts for specific decisions, but they might not nevertheless lend themselves to these kinds of global descriptions of the whole set of rules. And just to kind of follow on to what Jenna showed you earlier, everyone, of course, is talking about neural networks, deep learning, and although what Jenna showed you before is a kind of schematic representation of their learning process, you can actually render the decision-making, the learned decision-making process visually, and so this is actually just a highly contrived example, literally, of only two dimensions, using what would be called, if you remember Jenna's diagram, there are multiple kind of columns of nodes. This is just four columns of nodes, and you get this highly complex kind of ripple across the space. And so very quickly, you get, I think, the impression that even with a very limited set of dimensions, these things can be very difficult to understand at a global level, right? Building on what Andrew had mentioned earlier, I think there's an important distinction to be made between these different kinds of explanations. And so in a way, despite the complexity of a lot of these processes, we can still produce, in many cases, these accounts of a specific decision. We can say this is what seemed to be the most significant feature, the most significant dimension for that decision. It's far less obvious, even when you kind of very slowly introduce some of these additional kinds of complexity into the model, how to allow people to step through the logic completely on their own. How do they keep in mind all the kind of dependencies between the different things that are being modeled, right? So again, to think of this. But that is all very different from this third thing, which again, Andrew was introducing earlier, which is to say, like, how do people justify this as a basis of decision-making? So the obvious answer here would be something like, these patterns just represent historical, these are historical patterns in the data. The reason we make the decision this way is because that's what the historical pattern says is the most likely to predict the outcome we care about, right? But that is clearly a deeply dissatisfying answer. It's probably not enough to just simply say, these are the patterns and we're going to you know, justify all decisions on that basis. But it's clear that we can't even have this conversation about, you know, what is a legitimate basis of decision making if we can't understand the rules, right? And so I think this is, again, a way of emphasizing what Andrew was saying. I'll just end by saying that there are also, obviously, there is a considerable amount of work that's being done in computer science trying to ensure interpretability without necessarily having to pay some cost in performance, right? And one of the obvious ways this can be done is trying to limit the dimensions. How many features are you actually considering? Is it two features? Is it going to end up being something like Jenna described, where it's thousands of features? Are you going to use a different learning method? Is the method going to produce a linear classifier, something that's a straight line and much easier to explain? Or is it going to be this kind of much more curved space? Is it going to, are the features themselves individually going to satisfy monotonicity constraints? Meaning, you know, if I tell you what matters is your income, in which way? Does it matter like that as it goes up, it always corresponds to an increase in my credit score? Or is it change over the value of my income? And then finally, there's a significant amount of work that's being done on these kind of post hoc explanations, where trying to account for a particular determination using many, many other methods, where the goal is not to provide a global explanation, but instead to meaningfully explain what accounts for this specific decision. And I'll just say the very, very final thing is, you know, I want to suggest that there might not always be these trade-offs that are the kind of starting point of a lot of these discussions. In fact, I'm involved in some empirical work looking specifically at whether there is a tension between interpretability and performance using data about humans. And so far, a lot of that work hasn't actually demonstrated that this trade-off is very hard in this case. And I imagine, I don't think I'm going to put too much of a burden on Duncan, but I imagine Duncan will have something to say about this as well, where there are interesting questions about how to model social behavior as compared to these kind of more natural phenomena, and whether or not there is the same trade-off across the board. So thanks very much. And thanks to my intern, Jenna, for help with those awesome visualizations.
Thanks, Solon. And now we have Duncan Woods.
So I would like to talk a little bit about how some of the same issues come up in social science, and also possibly some differences in emphasis that social scientists have when they talk about explanation. So I think it's fair to say that that when social scientists talk about explanation, really what they mean is causal explanation. And sometimes they say causal explanation, and sometimes they don't put causal in there, but almost always, in one form or another, what they are meaning is, you know, something along the lines of what would have happened to some outcome Y had some input X been different, right? And so this is an almost universally accepted criterion for a valid explanation in social science. And it conforms almost exactly to the standard counterfactual model of causality that comes out of statistics, okay? So I think that's what social scientists think they mean when they say explanation. But if you then look at how they evaluate explanations in practice and in what they publish as explanations in their papers, it actually doesn't necessarily conform to this expectation, right? And so part of the reason for that is that actually doing causal inference properly is really difficult, right? And the more one reads about the assumptions and the theoretical conditions that are required to establish causal inference, it sort of becomes increasingly unclear that like anything that we do satisfies those conditions. So that's a big problem for us in social science. Another big problem is that a lot of the questions that we want to ask in social science, like, you know, what caused the financial crisis, or, you know, why did Enron collapse, are questions that are not even in principle answerable through this counterfactual model, which is designed to ask, you know, questions like, well, if input X had been different, how would that have affected Y? Not what are all possible reasons why might have happened, right? So there's a lot of you know answers that are given in social science that have the form of causal explanations that actually cannot even in principle be causal. And so finally, I just want to emphasize this is not sort of a distinction between qualitative and quantitative work. that, you know, a lot of quantitative work, you know, in the sort of tradition of hypothesis testing, is, you know, has again the sort of form of a predictive causal explanation, but the prediction is usually about the sign and significance of some coefficients in a model, and then having established that, even if correctly and satisfying causal inference premises, one then goes on in the discussion section to make some, you know, hand-waving interpretation of what has been established, and that is very much about interpretability. So it turns out that this conflation of, you know, on the one hand sort of pretending to talk about causal explanations, but on the other hand really sort of ultimately responding to the interpretability of explanations, really goes back all the way to the beginning in sociology, where Weber himself is kind of cagey about like what he means when he says explanation. So on the one hand, in the very same sentence, he says sociology is about interpretive understanding. It's about making sense of things. It's about putting yourself inside the head of the other actor and sort of persuading yourself that the things that he or she did are sort of sensible, right? They're understandable in this sort of very empathetic, interpretive sense. And then he says, this is how you get causal explanations, right? And it's not clear from Weber himself whether he thinks the interpretive understanding is the causal explanation or it's just something you need in order to get the causal explanation. He just kind of drops it at that point. And so this sort of confusion of what we mean when we talk about explanation really has kind of persisted throughout the sociology literature, and I think it's also true in other branches of social science. But they're really very different, right? So causal explanations, and this is, you know, is a statement that might seem controversial to some sociologists, but I think it's really not, is that causal explanations necessarily make predictions, right? So it's not true that predictions imply causality, but it is true that causality implies predictions. And so in order to make predictions, you have to have your explanation specified ex ante, and you have to evaluate it in terms of accuracy. But if you're talking about interpretation, you have a very different set of criteria, really, that it just makes sense, that it feels right, that it helps you have insight into what you observed already, and therefore it's intrinsically an ex post evaluation. And it's something that's evaluated not in terms of accuracy, but just plausibility. And then finally, I would say, neither one of these things implies the other, right? That it's not so much that there's necessarily, there may or may not be a trade-off between the two, but they're certainly not, they don't have to imply each other. You can have things that are very interpretable that are not predictive, and you can have things that are predictive and not interpretable. And so often, as soon as you bring up the notion of prediction in a room full of social scientists, everyone starts yelling at you. And there's lots of sort of, I think, misconceptions out there that are sort of have been repeated. We've been repeating to ourselves for so long in social science that we think they're true. And so things like, you know, predictions don't imply causality. That's true, but it may not be very important because we still need to get predictions at some point. Complex models generalize poorly. Maybe, right? Maybe they don't. Right? We actually, this is an active area of research in machine learning, and it's not at all clear that complex models generalize worse than simple models. And uninterpretable models don't provide insight, and so that's not science, right? And again, you know, I mean, it may be true that insight and interpretability go together, but insight is not causation, it's not generalization. And so if science is about understanding, getting at causality and getting at generalization, then it's not clear that these are the same thing. So I think really the point I want to make here is this slide, which is that there are different reasons to care about interpretability. Solon and Andrew make a very similar point in their paper. You can, with respect to explanation, you can care about interpretability just because you care about interpretability. Like, it is the end in itself. And to the extent that that is your reason for caring about interpretability, you can't be wrong, right? You just want what you want, okay? And that's okay, all right? But a second reason, and the reason that's usually given is this second reason, that they're not, you know, it's not that we care about it for its own sake, it's because we believe that it is a proxy for other things that we have objective reasons for caring about, like causality or generalization. And that is almost certainly wrong, okay? It's certainly wrong in principle, and it's very often wrong in practice. And so if you care about generalization, you should test for generalization. If you care about causality, you should test for causality. And then if you also care about interpretability, that's a separate thing that you can maximize for. So none of this is to say that interpretation is useless or that we shouldn't try to do it. I think that there are ways to try to get both, right? And I think that's something we should aim for, and all things equal, why not have the more interpretable explanation? I think also the trade-off is not necessarily bad, right? That there are lots of instances where very simple models can do almost as well, indistinguishably well, as complex models, and so that's great. Maybe the problem isn't so bad. And then finally, even aside from those benefits, interpretation is procedurally useful, and I think, again, Solon and Andrew make a similar remark about explanation. It sort of helps us in the scientific process of like motivating new questions, refining hypotheses, and so on. So even if at the end we have to satisfy ourselves with an explanation that's not interpretable, along the way of getting there and the exploratory research that is required to even get to something, I think that interpretation is really sort of essential for us as scientists. And so I'll just conclude with this slide where I've tried to sort of tie what I was just saying back to what I think is what I got from reading the papers from Jenna and Solon. And I think that you see analogous concerns coming up in the decision systems world as we have in the social science world, but for somewhat different reasons. And so I think there's sort of an interesting kind of juxtaposition of these issues where, in some cases we want different things, but in the end we have some of the same concerns. So I'll stop there. Thank you.
Many thanks. So I'm sure there are many questions from the audience. I would love to put the panelists in dialogue, and I have my own questions coming from a European law background and having all these new insights that are interdisciplinary. First I would open the floor to the audience and see whether there's some questions. You can use the microphone. And please introduce yourself when asking the question. It's right behind.
James Davenport, University of Bath and NYU. My question is really appealing to the wisdom of Solon, because I'm generalizing with his name. And you had an example where you said the distance to the maximum point of a credit score is so-and-so. Shouldn't it be the distance to the nearest point at which the credit score is sufficient to be scored? And there may be multiple of them, and so on. So can you even produce an explanation for the explanation?
Yeah, I mean, it's great. It's sort of to the point that there is not going to be a self-evident way of doing this, and for sure, you can imagine that what you care about is not the global maximum, but just to get to the nearest point where the person would have been given credit. So, yes, and I think what's interesting is that there certainly isn't any public statements about what standard has been adopted in the explanations that are generated by these credit-granting firms. So, yeah, that's a great point. Thank you.
Hi, Kathy Stramberg again. I had a couple of questions which are just sort of to anyone, I guess. One, I guess, is just a comment that I want to go back and emphasize the point I was trying to make earlier about accuracy and performance and what it really means, because I just think we don't want to lose track of the fact that at least when we're talking about decision making, part of accuracy is that we're deciding the thing that we think we are deciding, which is really kind of outside of the question of once we know the rule, did we train it right, and all that kind of stuff. But I also just wanted to bring up this question about, because I think one of the purposes of explanations that's very important, at least in law, in not all contexts, but in many contexts, is this idea that people should have a right to be able to respond to decisions that are being made about them by modifying what they do. And I think that this is one of the things that is actually at the heart of a lot of discomfort with predictive modeling that is just based on, that is, first of all, just based on data that's about what's been done in the past, and second of all, that is unexplained. So I think that this is maybe a sort of different kind of thing that sometimes it's called gaming the system, but in many kinds of circumstances, something that you might call gaming the system is actually something that we should expect people to have the right to do. And so to me, an interesting question is, when is that the case? Because if that's the case, then there's a problem with saying we made this prediction based on a million variables that's kind of outside of the question of how well are we able to predict. And I think this comes up in a lot of questions where we have tensions in our own values. You know, like we want to make this, the right decision about who to let out on bail, but we also want people to be able to order their lives so that they, you know, are more likely to get let out on bail, or et cetera. So just wanted to know what people's comments were on that.
Maybe we can start in the reverse order with Duncan, and then hear from Solon and Jenna on that point.
So I would say that those sorts of concerns fall into this sort of first category, that we just have an intrinsic desire to understand, you know, why things happen, right? Because that, you know, and maybe we have that because we want to do something about it, and maybe we have that because it just because, right? It just actually feels better to know that there are reasons for things. We are reason-seeking beings. And so I think it's, you know, I would continue to say that that's something that we should think about separately from these other issues about you know, whether explanations are proxies for, you know, in the case of social science, you know, causation and generalization, and in the case of decision systems, you know, accuracy, fairness. And then we can ask separately, do you have a right to that, right? So I think, you know, if you think about performance systems, right, you know, we you know, as employees, you would like to know, like, what levers you could pull to increase your performance rating and get, you know, a larger bonus or whatever. But from your employer's point of view, or maybe even from social welfare point of view, or your colleague's point of view, that may be a bad thing, right? Because then everybody starts gaming the performance metric, right? So as soon as you know, everybody knows that, you know, in order to get a bonus, you have to hit a certain target on a certain thing, then everybody focuses on doing that thing, and that turns out to be bad, right? And that's a huge problem in the literature on performance evaluation. And so maybe you want to have a performance evaluation that's like deliberately vague so that nobody can ever really know exactly what they did to get the performance that they got. And that might be frustrating to you as an employee, but you know, that's a sort of trade-off that one has to make between sort of the individual and the collective good and the principal and the agent and so on. So I think all of those arguments are, you know, reasonable, but I would put them all in that sort of first bucket of like, well, you know, do you have a right to have an explanation just because that's what you want?
Okay, I mean, I think it really depends on the domain we're talking about. And I certainly think that, you know, as a sociologist, I spoke at the beginning of my talk about social mobility. So if we're talking about the kinds of, you know, rulings that relate to those kind of key opportunities people have to make their lives better, then explanation is actually really critical, and I think the way social scientists think and the way the legal community thinks about this are really in sync. Whether or not you can get your website bumped up on Google search, I think from the perspective of Google, that's absolutely something they want to be protective of. They don't want people to know exactly how to game that system because they want to be able to rank things according to some principle about kind of information, the value of information based on search terms. And so that's a scenario where I think a certain amount of ambiguity is probably important for the value of that, of the search engine. Whereas if we're talking about whether or not you get access to credit, it's really important, I think, for people to know how they can do better, how they can get access to more credit, how they can, you know, take out debt so they can you know, advance themselves.
Great. In the interest of time, maybe I'm going to take now three questions because there are a lot of people in the queue already, and then let the speakers respond. Thanks.
Oh, Mark McCarthy. A quick question on the interpretability in social science. I think that is a real contrast in social science between the people who are going for understanding and the people who are looking for causal explanation. But in the machine learning context more generally, the problem is that often you don't even have good causal explanations as opposed to some more standard ways of analyzing things. So the typical example, the analysis of children's medical information, premature babies born, who analyzed hundreds of thousands of records, and they developed a correlation between all of the vital signs going flat 24 hours before the onset of a dangerous fever. They didn't really know what was going on, but they knew enough to take action to try to, you know, prevent the problem from arising. So the real question, isn't it, when can you take action on the basis of these machine learning connections without being able to tell a causal story? And if you can't tell a causal story, you can't give a good explanation and people don't really know what's going on. But sometimes you still need to be able to take action. And the question is, when is that?
Thank you. We will take some more questions and then have the answers after.
Hi, I'm Julia Powers. I'm at Cornell Tech. I think it's really, I've been struck by this panel as a CS panel following the law panel. And I'm curious to Jenna whether there isn't actually more homogeneity in how we approach these problems based on our actual personal experience of the world, and in particular, whether we're more comfortable with decisions made by machines or by humans, and perhaps our own experience of whether we trust and understand our fellow beings and the magnificent, complex, changeable nature of people and institutions rather than models. And that sort of leads into a question to Duncan and Solon. I think that the problem with this characterization of the social sciences is it tries to bring the critique into the model itself, rather than whether we're comfortable to allocate decision-making to models, to generalization, to prediction, which of course have the inherent limits of whatever statistical model or other operations you're applying to them.
Thank you. And one more question.
All right. So Andrew Burton with a data science startup called Immuta and a visiting fellow at Yale Law School's ISP. So question spurred by Solon's slide on DARPA's explainable AI. So I love that slide and slides like it because it makes clear that there are different levels of inscrutability based on the models. And so what I want to ask you or any member of the panel is if you can envision a future where data scientists are said, for this particular task, these models cannot be used. So if that is a future, what that decision looks like. Thanks.
So maybe some time for the panelists now to answer. Start from Solon, maybe?
Sure, so maybe just working backwards quickly. Yeah, so different learning methods are likely to produce more or less inscrutable models, but there are other qualities of the model themselves besides the learning method that might account for the inscrutability. So for instance, as I'm sure you'll hear probably in the next panel, even things that are widely understood to be much more understandable, like a linear regression, can become pretty complicated to grasp if you have a huge number of parameters, right? Or things like that. So, you know, there really isn't going to be a clear-cut way of saying, like, these methods okay, these methods not okay, because it seems to be something that interacts with many other things that you're choosing when building a model. In the interest of time, maybe I'll just answer that one question. So.
Well, I'm intrigued by the second question. I'm not sure I quite understood what the question was. And I'm scanning the room to see if I can see the person who asked it.
It's whether I have an instinct that there's a particular bias in those who are very enthusiastic about an increasing role for automated decision making, that is coupled with perhaps a less comfort with decision
Yeah. I mean, yeah, so I think there's an essential question there, which is whether we're better off having, you know, despite whatever shortcomings, whether we're better off having machine learning algorithms make classification decisions. And I think what I was trying to show through my example was, you know, we can extract these kinds of explanations, but we tend to reason about those explanations in ways that are very human, and what's actually happening to make those decisions are kind of mathematical procedures. And I think there's a real gap between machine thinking and human thinking that we may be misleading ourselves in trying to kind of bridge between the two. I kind of want to hijack the question and answer, you know, session, because I think you brought something up, and I kind of wanted to talk to Duncan about what he means by social science, because I'm in here kind of representing computer science perspectives, but I'm an interpretivist, and I'm an ethnographer, and I don't do causal explanations at all. I also don't do prediction, and so the social science you're talking about, I don't exactly recognize as an approach that I see in my work, or as a, you know, predictive work is not really a shortcoming, I think, in the work that I'm doing, because I'm not trying to do causal explanation. I think maybe in kind of your terms, what I'm trying to do is discover what's in the world to identify the variables that we may then end up doing kind of models and causal explanations for, but I don't put a lot of stock in kind of singular, kind of isolated causal explanation. And I think when we're talking not about the physical sciences, but the social sciences, we're talking about, you talk about complexity, I think we have some major barriers there to things like replicability, which is that certainly you can expect, you know, a prediction to hold if you have the exact same set of features in the world relating to each other in exactly the same way, and often we just don't see that. So there's that question of replicability, and also there's the question of these models of the social world, we're wise to them. And if you're talking about like gaming search engines, the problem with a lot of those models is they try to kind of model the world in a way that assumes humans will not kind of clue into those models and start to undermine them and change them by, we're self-aware organisms. And that's another reason why those kind of physical science approaches don't work very well for social scientific approaches.
We would have to arm wrestle about this later, my short answer is I everything I said applies like exactly to ethnography, right? It may be sort of covered up in different ways, but I guarantee you that I can read an ethnography paper and find causal statements, right? They may be,
but that's not the point of the ethnography.
No,
right. Like you can find it there if you're applying a positive.
No,
positivist
it,
frame, but
so
that's
it
not
seems
the point
that this
of
is going
so, okay,
to go
I would say
into the lunch discussion. I'm just going to allow maybe more questions from the audience.
Okay, sorry, can I answer one of the questions?
Yeah.
So the first question that was asked was about the relationship between causation and prediction, and whether interpretation, as I would reframe it, interpretation is sort of a necessary modulating variable between the two, right? So it's absolutely clear that you can make accurate predictions that tell you nothing about causal mechanisms, right? And in fact, naive interpretation of predictive models might lead you to exactly the opposite causal explanation than the true one, right? And so I'd say, you know, in situations like that, it's very, if you care about intervention, right, if you're caring about changing the system, then you do care about causality. And in those cases, you want to be very careful to have done the causal inference correctly, right? Now, one way to do that might be to, you know, have some interpretable statement of the mechanism involved, right? And if that is true, that could be a useful way to get to your goal. But the point that I was trying to make is that the goal is to do causal inference correctly, and it's possible to do that without necessarily having an interpretable explanation, and it's possible not to do that even with an interpretable explanation. And so I think that, you know, interpretability is just a third criteria, right? So I would say prediction, causation, interpretability are three things. We care about all of them, and you don't necessarily get any one from the others, right? So, which is not to say that you can't, but you don't necessarily, right?
So that's, I think, the point that I was trying to make.
Okay, thanks. Now maybe we'll take just the rest of the questions and have some last round of answers.
Hi, my name is Martha. I'm with the Committee on Global Thought at Columbia. I am going to pick on Solon because he, speaking about my favorite topic, which is credit scoring. So I have to urge you to be cautious when you take that as a case, because it's the best case because it's such an influential decision, but it's also the worst case because of the issue of causality. So let's take 2010 for an example. In a weakening economic situation, many of the major banks realized that people had these large credit lines and that because they were, say, losing their jobs and other things, they were going to start running them up. So you might have a credit line of $5,000, you might only be using $1,000. So what the banks did is they cut those lines. Mm-hmm. And what happens is FICO scores across the country plummeted. Now, what is the explanation for those scores plummeting? It's bank policy. It has mm-hmm. nothing to do with individual behavior. Mm-hmm. So I would have to say that looking at this from a financial perspective in the context of what it is in markets, if you look at those various topographies that you show, the difference between them has nothing to do with some kind of organic behavior in human beings, but it has more to do with things like monetary policy, the interest rate set by the Fed, transnational capital flows, whether European banks are borrowing US dollars in euro dollar markets and lending them to American citizens, and things like bank policy. So what is the explanation that the American people need to have for why their score is what there is? To make this a conversation about epistemology is actually to not give them that answer. And credit scoring is actually the one case where you can show that the best. And I felt that your paper did the inverse of that. So, my comment.
You can hold your breath and then we'll take the rest of the questions.
Hi, I'm Lauren Hansen from Data and Society. My question is for Solon and Jenna. So you both brought up examples where you can look at a particular result and trace backwards to the logic of the model that was used to achieve that result in a fairly scalable and generalizable way. But I was wondering what you think about the feasibility of explanation for personalization algorithms and how the challenges in scrutability there might be similar or different from the examples that you brought up.
Thank you. And two more questions.
Hey, my name is Zachary Lipton. I'm from UCSD and almost from CMU. So I'd like to address a particular issue. I'll pick on Solon again, just because it's a popular thing to do. So I think we're using the word, well, I think there's two notions of causality at play here. One is the model recovering causal structure in the universe when you train it? Another is the fact that the model has a causal effect upon the environment in which it interacts. And so specifically, I bring this up, or it picks on Solon just because of the idea of how useful is a local explanation. So this idea that given all of your other features, say we're talking about credit, but you know, it could be anything, the idea of prescribing actions, which has been sort of a recurring theme so far this morning, like if you do this, then this is the direction of maximum ascent immediately. There's something very strange about that because you're sort of making a prescription based on a model that it's a supervised model typically at almost anything you're doing, at least in all of my experience in real world machine learning, 100% of it is supervised learning that's actually out there doing anything or being used to inform decisions. It's not trained with any idea of what is a good kind of behavior to incentivize. And so as a very simple explanation, you can imagine doing something very stupid, which is you train a highly nonlinear model and you say, I'm going to predict creditworthiness based on income. And then say there's some weird anomaly in the data, like there's a whole bunch of people who have a very specific job title, have a very specific credit characteristic, and those people all make exactly $117,000. And you make $119,000. So your local explanation probably would be, and say those people are like awesome at credit, like they always repay everything because they come from some very trustworthy vocation. And so now if you make $119,000, the model might very well say, our one-dimensional, non-monotonic model has said, if you make $117,000, you're awesome. So you should do that. And you'll go out and you'll lower your income. And so, I mean, this has been a recurring theme. But I think what I'd add to it is just, is there a fundamental silliness of making recommendations about what you should do based on a model that doesn't know anything about anyone doing anything? The very notion of an action doesn't exist in the model. And we're taking like life advice from it. Okay.
Thank you. And then the last question of Helen Eisenbaum.
Hi, I want to sort of go back to something Kathy said about why explanation is important in order to give people an opportunity to respond and shape their lives. And of course, this issue of gaming a system is perhaps a concern. But and why I'm deeply bothered by the DARPA, the way DARPA would say there's performance and interpretability, and they seem to be a trade-off between those two things. Because it, and again, I think it's, I'm trying to see whether Duncan's three, you know, interpretation, prediction, and causation are somehow a response to this concern, which is the performance versus interpretability trade-off suggests that we know what performance is. We know that this is the thing, and we have like some kind of external measure of what that valued end is, and that interpretability is this kind of side constraint that's a little bit annoying. And what it would mean in a world to say that actually interpretability or explainability or the ability to shape your life according to these decisions about you is part of this performance metric and not set aside as this peripheral constraint.
Great. So we'll start maybe with Duncan again and have all of the panelists pick up some of the points that were touched upon, because we don't have much more time, but the discussion will continue over lunch, I'm sure, and during the whole conference afterwards.
Yeah, I think just to answer Helen's question, I totally agree that we should think about, it's appropriate to think about interpretability as a performance metric, right? I think the point that I'm trying to make is to be clear about why, right? And one reason you might, you know, care about interpretability is because you just care about it, right? And that's fine, right? But the concern that I have that's mostly coming from thinking about social scientific explanations is that it's sort of that other reasons are given that are that where I think the real reason is, you know, that we just care about interpretability, right? That we The typical reason is, you know, interpretability matters because of science, or because, you know, we care about generalization and uninterpretable things don't generalize well, or that they're not, you know, we can't extract causal mechanisms from them. And my point is just, if you care about those things, measure those things, right? And if you care about interpretability, then measure interpretability, and that they're really just separate things. And so I think that, you know, my sort of skepticism of explanations is that because we do care so much about interpretability, it can be used as a way to disguise flaws in these other metrics, right? That when someone gives you a really plausible explanation, you stop asking questions, right? You think, oh, that sounds right, we're done. Okay, and I think that's an enormous problem in social policy, in the media, in all the explanations that we read about everything that happens in the world, right? That you just sort of, somebody says, here's a story, and you say, oh, that sounds right. And if they'd given you a different story, that would also have sounded right, but it would have been a completely different causal explanation with completely different implications for the future and policy and everything else, right? But you don't think that. You just think, oh, that sounds plausible. I can see why that makes sense. And so I think that, you know, if we are sort of using interpretability and plausibility as like the most important thing because we think it means these other things, then that can lead to enormous errors. That is really my concern.
I wanted to pick up on the question about using kind of machine learning algorithms to tell us how to be that are kind of stupid in certain ways that don't have values, right? That are, and I think there's a, and on one hand, I think it makes sense, right? That if you're looking at how do I get a loan and how can I be able to pay back that loan? Looking at all the examples of people who took out loans and paid back those loans and didn't default, that's you know, fairly good guideline, even though the machine that is kind of optimizing around those features isn't telling you how to be. It's still useful as a model to think, okay, I want to get a loan and I want to pay it back, so I will follow these, you know, do these things in my life that other people who've paid back loans are doing. But my worry, which I share with many other sociologists and people who are concerned about issues of inequality, is that that's merely replicating the system that we have today, and it's not really doing a critique of the system in any way. And there are problems with that system. Thinking about some of the things that have been coming out recently about ways in which poor Americans become even poorer through legal fees, right? Or, you know, bonds that they owe, or things like that. That's sort of a revelation in the among legal scholars and sociologists that this is a problem that's keeping poor people poor. And a machine learning model is not really going to account for that kind of thing. It's not kind of aware of how there might be things like systematic inequality and how to identify and kind of alleviate those forms of systematic unfairness. And I think we have to look to other approaches to do that kind of work.
I'll try to do a bunch of this very quickly. These were all
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Okay, these were all incredibly good questions and really, really provocative. I think there's a fair amount of overlap, actually. So I think when Helen is asking, you know, shouldn't we be taking into account people's sort of autonomy and their ability to make like reasoned decisions about how to interact with these systems, is sort of similar to the point that Lipton, I forget. Zach, thank you, sorry. Was making by saying, like, you know, these systems are sort of agnostic on what it means to change the value of a particular feature and might actually encourage people to do totally irrational things like reduce their income because that just happens to be what patterns have been learned in the data. And, you know, I think, like, there's two things here. One is to say, along the lines of what Kathy, I think, was arguing earlier, is that, you know, what we should be doing is saying, like, we're building models where the only way to game the system is to actually, like, do the thing we want people to do. So Kathy O'Neill has a very compelling example of this in education, where the model used to kind of assess the relative contribution of someone to, like, the score of their students is based on what she argues are weak proxies that can be easily manipulated. And from her perspective, that makes no sense. The idea is that the only way you should be able to game the system is by becoming a better teacher. Right? And so it is a really interesting, provocative idea to say we should take into account what it would mean to think about how people can act strategically on these kinds of explanations. And in fact, I'll just mention very quickly that people are working at the intersection of game theory and machine learning specifically with this in mind. Right? Can you find things that are either very costly, practically speaking, to change so that you can disclose them, or the alternative, which is sort of what I think you were suggesting, Zach, which is, can we, like, purposefully produce models that incentivize people to behave in ways that serve their own interests and things like that? And not to avoid Martha's very, very good and difficult question. but, you know, what I would say here is that I think what you're raising is that there are, to begin with, background conditions which are often, like, taken for granted and when we in the process of validating these tools, right? So whatever relationship we might define in the data is only true under some stable set of conditions. And if the world changes, including policy changes, those validations are no longer trustworthy, right? But there's an even kind of more important point, which is to say that, like, often when Andrew was talking about these design decisions, like, what is the meaning of the score even for the company producing the score? Or what is the purpose of the score within the particular institution? And those are questions sort of external, completely external to whatever the model might be doing. And I think that's precisely the kind of stuff that you've been so good at excavating. So I would try to find a way to contort the argument that we're making to actually be very compatible with what you're saying.
Perfect. So great. Please join me in thanking all the panelists for an excellent discussion.